tuning into the Valkyrie Ensemble's first episode of Suffragette Summer, a celebration of the 100th year anniversary of the women's right to vote in the United States.
Thank you for being here today.
This 5-episode series will focus on the history of the suffragette movement. We will highlight the pioneers who made it possible, issues that women still face both in the U.S. and worldwide, and how we can emulate and honor the suffragettes by exercising our only century-old right to vote. We will be closing each video with a song from or pertaining to the suffragette movement to further the Valkyries Ensemble's mission to promote and empower women in and through music. All right, so let's just go ahead and jump right into it. 100 years is a lot to cover, so I would suggest making yourself comfortable like me. Oh, well, it's 5 o'clock somewhere. On August 18th, 1920, the 19th Amendment to the Constitution was ratified, granting women in the United States the right to vote. This ended nearly a 100-year battle for activists who had begun pioneering for it before the Civil War. Since the very beginning of U.S. history, women have been involved in reform groups, ranging from temperance leagues, anti-slavery, religious organizations, and even moral reform societies. So, why did it take so long to gain the right to vote? Well, there are several reasons, but the main setbacks were war, politics, the evolving role of women, and gender equality.
Tom?
I couldn't afford enough premium carpet to get us to the stage. I mean, it was a short walk, but it was pretty luxurious, right?
Our first major milestone for women's suffragettes was in 1848 at the Seneca Falls Convention held in New York, where activists met to discuss the problem of women's rights. It was led by famous activists Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Lucretia Mott. The convention concluded that American women were autonomous individuals who deserved their own political identities. It also holds importance because it was the first time that abolitionists had a common goal for women's politics. However, the debate over whether men and women were created equal still loomed in the background and would cause disagreement for decades to come.
What are you doing?
Just hear me out. What is more important than quality? Equality.
Beginning in 1860, the Civil War brought immense death, destruction, and debt, forcing the women's movement to take a back seat while the country began to rebuild and reform. With heightened racial tensions coming out of the war, the African-American male's right to vote took to the forefront. While many supported the ratification of the 15th Amendment, there were many who opposed it, causing a temporary split between the American suffragettes in the North and the South.
You can't sit with us!
Between 1869 to 1890, Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony fought for a universal suffrage amendment to be added to the United States Constitution.
Okay, I just have to interrupt just for a second. Look at Susan B. Anthony's side eye. Look at that! Look what the patriarchy did to her! Hashtag side eye Susan.
Another smaller group of suffragettes pushed for individual states to allow women's voting instead of advocating federally. In 1890, the two groups merged and became the National Women's Suffrage Association with a new approach. Instead of advocating for the women's vote because men and women were created equal, they offered that women deserved to vote because they were different than men. These women should be crowned the mothers of reverse psychology, since they played on the idea of domesticity and maternal instinct to help their cause. In the past, these arguments had been used to discourage the women's vote due to the sexist idea that women might forget their place in the home or wear themselves too thin if given this new responsibility.
Wear themselves too thin?
Mop the floor!
Forget their place?
Make me a sandwich!
Are you kidding me?
Salami, please.
I'm sorry for the interruption. I just needed a couple seconds to remember my place.
I said white bread.
While this might seem like a frustrating step backwards for this progressive organization, it was a necessary tactic that needed to be made at the time. Towards the end of the 19th century, Idaho and Utah granted women the right to vote. and in 1910, many other Western states began to follow suit. Still, Southern and Eastern states would not budge. Suffragette Carrie Chapman Catt, the new NAWSA president, pushed for a winning plan, a campaign that focused on the Southern and Eastern states, encouraging their politicians to reconsider their stances. Suffragette and women's warrior Alice Paul organized pickets and hunger strikes in front of the White House, demanding suffrage for women.
Bless you, suffragettes. Tastes like equality.
World War I slowed the campaign, but the suffragettes fought tirelessly, and on August 18th, 1920, they had accomplished it at last. To show our gratitude for these suffragettes. Not only did they face sexism, rejection, and often danger for fighting for what they believed in, but they never let a man define their place and did not give up the fight. Thank you, suffragettes, for your sacrifice. I promise to never take my right to vote for granted.
Cast off the shackles of yesterday, shoulder to shoulder into the fray. Our daughters' daughters will adore us, and they'll sing in grateful chorus. Well done, sister suffragette.
Thank you so much again for tuning into the Valkyrie Ensemble's first episode of Suffragette Summer. While there are many women that we didn't have a chance to talk about today, we want to honor them by performing Ethel Smyth's March of the Women. Ethel Smyth was a British composer who wrote in support of the suffragette movement in Britain, but her song has been used across the world as a battle cry for equality. Thank you so much.
Shout, shout, oh.